Greetings. This is part 5, reviewing an Islamic poem titled, O Christ Worshippers. The author, Ibn Qayyim, lived from 1292 to 1350. I'm amazed that these arguments from 700 years ago are virtually unchanged. Let's get to the next refrain and see what awaits an answer.
Were all the worlds left without a god, to manage while his hands were nailed? Why did not the angels help him when they heard him while he wailed?
The first line about worlds without a god is completely answered in the previous video. The revelation that God is a Trinity is the only answer which successfully, logically, explains Jesus being God in the flesh from God the Father, who is a spirit without a flesh body, on the throne. John 4:24, God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship him in spirit and in truth. If you are Muslim, I encourage you, brother, to attempt to understand the definitions that Christianity defines. If you want to understand Islam, you must use the definition Islam stands upon, like the word Muslim. One cannot change the definition of Muslim to mean a person submitted to their God. Sounds similar, but it introduces ambiguity about which God they follow. A Satanist is submitted to their God Satan. Does that make them a Muslim because they are submitted? No, because the Islamic definition of Muslim means submission to the Allah of Islam. Likewise, brother, when you attempt to understand Christian teaching, you must do so using the definitions of the terms Christians would use. The term Trinity is defined and used to describe God as he has revealed himself by his prophets. Until you understand how Christians arrived at the definition of Yahweh God as a Trinity, it may be confusing to you. It may even be offensive to you, brother, because of the definition of monotheism you have been taught. Some define monotheism as God is one, alone. But that is only one dimension of the deity that monotheism attempts to describe. If Allah is one alone, where is Allah? If Allah is one alone, can Allah be in more than one place? Try and logically apply the same questioning of the poem against Allah. How does Allah hear every prayer everywhere on earth? How does Allah do it when he is one alone sitting above Mecca? Answers to questions such as these indicate if a religion was made up by men as time passed. Definitions will change over time as people realize the old definition did not make sense. So, what is Allah that he lives in a paradise of physical, sensual pleasures? Does Allah offer a physical paradise of sensual pleasure because you have a physical body with physical needs when you die? When I ask Muslims to explain their religion, asking for answers to such questions, the answers I get sound made up on the spot, and the definition of terms changes to fit the moment and avoid the obvious logical problem. For example, what is death? What is Islam's definition of death? From the Quran, I only read phrases like, to Allah we return. What returns to Allah? Your physical body with physical needs for sensual pleasure and lusts to fulfill? I honestly find that Islam simply cannot create definitions and concepts that are stable and may be questioned. So we are examining an Islamic poem titled, O Christ Worshippers. And I find so far that every line, every concept arises from ignorance of the Christian teachings, imagining that when Christ was dead, that God was dead, is a perfect example, ignorant of even the Christian concept of death. Let's move along.
Why did not the angels help him when they heard him while he wailed?
Short answer, because angels are obedient to God and God's commands. Daniel 9:23, at the beginning of your supplications, prayers, the command was issued, and I have come to tell you, for you are highly esteemed, so give heed to the message and gain understanding of the vision. God gave the command, and Archangel Gabriel was sent to Daniel. It is logical and reasonable the command came from God, because it included prophetic information. It is also logical because who but God commands archangels? And while not directly stated, the Bible recounts stories that imply angels are all around us, perhaps all the time. 2 Kings 6:15. Now, when the attendant of the man of God had risen early and gone out, behold, an army with horses and chariots was circling the city. And his servant said to him, Alas, my master, what shall we do? Elisha's servant could see the physical army around them and was afraid. So he, Elisha, answered, Do not fear, for those who are with us are more than those who are with them. I recall a teacher once dramatizing the servant's reaction, looking, pointing, and counting. One, two. Then Elisha prayed and said, O Lord, I pray, open his eyes that he may see. And the Lord opened the servant's eyes, and he saw. And behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. The implication is that angels may be all around us, perhaps all the time, and we just do not see them.
Why did not the angels help him when they heard him while he wailed?
Well, that may be even worse, right? The implication is that angels all around Jesus did not help him. The issue which you must consider then is plan, command, and obedience. Any time that Jesus had wanted rescue or aid or assistance, it was only a request or command away. Matthew 23:53, or do you think, this is Jesus talking, or do you think that I am not able to call upon my Father, and he will furnish to me presently more than 12 legions of angels? Jesus only needed to ask, and angels would have come immediately. And you have no idea what you are up against when you fight angels. 2 Kings 19:35. And that night the angel of the Lord went out and struck down 185,000 in the camp of the Assyrians. And when people arose early in the morning, behold, these were all dead bodies. 185,000. This says angel, not angels. One angel killed 185,000 Assyrian soldiers. A legion is 5,000. 12 legions is 60,000. If each can kill 185,000 in a night, they could combined kill 11 billion. Jesus said that at his call, God would send enough angels to kill 11 billion people overnight. Think about that. Enough angel power to kill all of humanity available at the tip of his tongue. And yet Jesus never made the request. because it was not in God's will. God's will and God's plan to implement His will was revealed by the prophets. Psalm 22, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me, so far from my cries of anguish? My God, I cry out by day, but you do not answer, by night, but I find no rest. Prophet David revealed what Messiah cried out from the cross. Or you can believe Jesus chose to recite Prophet David in the middle of gasping for breath, trying to gather his thoughts while his body was racked with pain. Either concept links the death of Messiah to the message of Prophet David in the Psalms. Psalm 22:8, He trusts in the Lord, they say. Let the Lord rescue him. Let him deliver him, since he delights in him. Matthew 27:43, He trusts in God. Let God deliver him now if he wants. For he said, I am the Son of God. The prophets revealed details of the crucifixion because it was the plan God always had. Yet you brought me out of the womb. You made me trust in you, even at my mother's breast. From birth, I was cast on you. From my mother's womb, you have been my God. Why does that sound familiar? May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.